You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Welcome to HUM 310, the American musical. I'm Bill DeLuca, and I'm delighted to entertain you today with what is a very unique topic. We are looking at the musicals of the 70s and 80s. So we're going to get to the longest running musical of all time, Phantom of the Opera, today. But this is a course that looks at how our musicals reflect our own society. So a lot of what happened in the 70s and 80s was very interesting the way it was reflected in the shows that people went to see. A good reflection question for today would be, how do the 70s and 80s musicals reflect a more fragmented society? And we'll talk about that briefly as well. So that's a good focus question for us today on this, our sixth broadcast. In fact, just in terms of some announcements for the class, our next week's broadcast is broadcast number 7, our final broadcast. So we are coming around the final turn for the course. And even though this week we've done basic readings, next week there's a lot of assignments coming up because you have the discussion boards will involve not just a reading from the final chapters of our text, the Bush-Jones text, as well as Scott Miller's readings, but you're responsible for turning in your final paper and a video that is a shortened version of that that you're going to send up to the YouTube site, as you did with your fan letter. So just want to kind of caution you to make sure that you look online at the guidelines for both the paper as well as the speech that goes along with it. Realize that the paper, if you look at the guidelines, it kind of clarifies that it's a thesis-based paper. In other words, your point is, I chose this specific musical because it says something about America at the time, and that has been a lot of what we've done in the course. Please look through the guidelines. They'll tell you things like, this is a thesis-based paper, and its main objective is to reveal how your selected musical is a reflection of American life, using research to provide supporting evidence. In fact, in the guidelines, I have some questions that could help you to think about how your musical might apply. In either case, you need to argue your position by explaining how specific examples from the musical support it. So really, the best thing to do is to look at lyrics from the musical. Maybe you analyze the actual music. Maybe Richard Rodgers has done something with arpeggios that somehow reflect what the song is supposed to be saying about the characters and the plot. Or you may find something about the actual composer or librettist, something from their lives that lend more insight into how this was a reflection of America at that time. It may come from the scene design. It may come from what they're wearing in terms of costumes. So this is a very integrative paper. You're drawing from many different artists that create a musical, but it's all basically to give you evidence to support your claim, which is why you think it's somehow reflective of America at the time. And the speech, the video that you're going to do of the speech, is obviously a shortened version of that. But again, as you did quite successfully with the fan letter video, make sure that you're standing away from the camera. The microphone should be able to pick up your voice, but don't sit down. Stand up so that we see you from waist up, which gives you the reason to want to gesture, which gives you also reason to want to express your enthusiasm and get more vocal delivery. So that's not just a technical requirement. It's meant to promote a little bit more of a public and enthusiastic tone in how you deliver your speech. And I know it's odd to speak to a camera rather than to an audience, but many students have said they appreciate speaking to their laptop rather than to 50 students in a class. Not that that is going to ensure that you become a great public speaker. You do need to speak in front of people to be able to develop that skill fully. But it can really help you to organize and kind of plan out what you're going to do by these versions that we're doing of speaking to your laptop. Okay, so that's what's coming up. And also, unfortunately, next week on Friday of the following week, of the 20th and 21st, our final exam is going to be online there. So please check the website for what's covered. You know that it's the numbered items in our outline and the three musicals, and there's an article on the what a performer has to do to act out a song, not just sing it. And then finally, yes, our final broadcast is going to be next Saturday, which is June 21st. And I hope to have you there on the broadcast. We can interact and I can show perhaps some of your videos. Okay, so let's look at some of these amazing musicals that came out of the 70s and 80s. Of course, as we move away from the 60s into the 1970s, it's a grim turn of events, starting with the Kent State shootings. For anyone who was in college then, I know that for my own self, that was a frightening realization about Vietnam and what was happening to our country. It seemed like as we turned into the 70s, with Watergate coming in and the Roe versus Wade abortion debate dividing us, we even had in the feminist movement a lot of antagonism between black feminist women who felt that they weren't included in the feminist movement, that it was mostly white women, and there was some truth to that. So there was a lot of divisive issues that brought us into the 60s and obviously out of the 60s into the 70s. And obviously the resignation of a president had a very cold effect. All that was reflected in many of the musicals. I think we have a shot of the Kent State shootings there just to kind of point out just the violence here. This was a student protest march that happened in Ohio, and four students end up dead. Dead. I mean, it was so shocking to the world that Vietnam is obviously not a war that happened in Southeast Asia. It was happening in America as well. So that kind of colder feeling led us into the 70s in a very strange way. So a lot of the echoes of the kind of anger were there in shows like Maud Donna, which was a feminist show that was just very, very preachy and only got to play 48 times. Lovely Ladies, Kind Gentlemen was a show that was a remake of Tea House of the August Moon. No Asian American actors in the show, so it brought out the Asian American community in protest. Shows like The Lieutenant, 1975, which was an attempt to show what happened with William Kelly and the My Lai Massacre, which was a horrible event in Vietnam. It was much too in your face. But there were many shows like I'm Getting My Act Together and Taking It on the Road, 1978, that understood, this was Gretchen Cryer and Nancy Ford, who had a very upfront honesty with what they did. And it was a look at women in the workplace. It was feminist, but it was a lot of fun. And strangely enough, it was the black musicals of the time that learned how to make that adjustment. Remember, in the 60s, the black musical disappeared. But when it came back with shows like Pearly and The Wiz, black musicals now were here, as the graphic says, they were here for keeps. And they continued right on to the end of the century. Shows like Treemonisha, same year that The Wiz played, 1975, brought back Scott Joplin's music. Shows like Me and Bessie recreated Bessie Smith's rise to fame. We had a black cast of Hello Dolly with Pearl Bailey. Bubbling Brown Sugar was a wonderful show. Rosetta Lenore was quite a consummate artist in New York, and she devised, along with Lofton Mitchell, the history of African American music. And it really was almost educational as well as entertaining. Your Arms Are Too Short to Box with God was a very funny but also very moving show that Vinette Carroll and Mickey Grant devised out of a kind of a spiritual revival meeting. So it involved a lot of very, very vibrant singing. Ain't Misbehavin' was a terrific show all about Fats Waller's music. This is 1978. and a lot of great dancing. And speaking of great dancing, Yubi was another black musical that featured both the Hines brothers dancing. I was fortunate enough to see that. It was just stupendous. But a lot of the great music of Yubi Blake, who did our 1921 landmark production of Shuffle Along, as well as many others. So black musicals had kind of figured it out. Shows like Sophisticated Ladies, which was all of Duke Ellington's music, a retrospective that featured Judith Jameson, some great dancers, and Greg Hines was in that as well. So black musicals were no longer in your face. They were doing things like Dreamgirls that were compelling stories that brought you right into the harshness, in this case, of the Motown scene, and very much a bit of a nostalgic look going back into the 50s girl groups. Obviously, everyone thought it was Diana Ross and the Supremes who were being shown there. It was a great cover page from Ebony with Loretta Devine in there, who has done so well in her career. But here's a little clip from the original. Now, this is not Beyoncé. Hopefully you did see the movie, which was an interesting take. But long before there was Jennifer Holliday, there was Jennifer, long before there was Jennifer Hudson, there was Jennifer Holliday. This is Jennifer Holliday who created the role in Dreamgirls. So I think you'll see it's quite compelling music and drama as well. So this is from Dreamgirls. I mean, I saw that show with my mother, 1981, and she was first to stand up to do a standing ovation right at that moment with everybody else in the theater. So compelling, so engaging. And Michael Bennett did the choreography. I don't know if you noticed in that first clip, there were these towers, these metal towers, and the way that they moved around and they had lights on them was just wonderful stagecraft. You got fascinated with how the dancers worked in and out of those towers. So it was on many different levels, quite entertaining, obviously, but moving. Very powerful, powerful song there by Jennifer Holliday. And the black musical continued with great shows like Tap Dance Kid, 1983. There was a show, Williams and Walker, about Burt Williams and his partner, George Walker. That was beautifully done. We had Serafina come over from South Africa. This was a protest musical that was basically out to kind of praise the rebel leader, Nelson Mandela, and look at issues there in South Africa at the time. Black and Blue was a celebration of jazz that featured a young Savion Glover, new talent there. Jelly's Last Jam was a wonderful play, 1992 play, musical that George C. Wolfe created that was about Jelly Roll Morton, the man who at the beginning of the 20th century claimed that he had invented jazz. His music was fabulous. I don't know if he could make that claim logically, but fabulous dancing, but also it was historical. It was very educational. Bring in the Noise, Bring in the Funk, George C. Williams also did that and brought in Savion Glover to dance that. That was, I mean, amazingly, a history of African-American life through tap dance. So, and you see the dancers there, but quite a moving piece and just so electric in terms of the energy there of the dancers. So yes, the Black musical was back for keeps and was doing quite well. Meanwhile, in the 70s, mainstream America had moved into something of a darker period. The 60s was a vibrant time of great conflict. But people were not apathetic in the 60s, but they were in the 70s. And that was reflected very much in the kind of musicals, what our author, Bush Jones, refers to as the fragmented musical. I've had a number of students talk about this in the discussion boards, talking about how these are the musicals that feature irony and paradox. Sometimes the characters were just as fragmented as the musicals. Songs might interrupt the story. And it kind of ushered in that time called the me mentality of the late 70s. And I remember living in New York at the time, walking into a bookstore, and you would see a whole section called self-help books. It seemed like the 60s shook us up, and then the 70s depressed us, and people needed some personal nurturing. So the movement from public arenas to private ones, it's very true about the late 70s. This is where we have Phil Donahue all of a sudden has a television show where people are out there talking about their inner troubles. The first of the big talk shows start their late 70s. So whether it was the Iran hostage crisis or the recession, I mean, people sitting in line to get gas two blocks down the street from the from the gas station, it was an amazing time there. America had just lost in Vietnam. Soldiers were coming back, not to parades. And it was a horrible situation. The MIA, the missing in action situation, was very difficult. So it was a dark time, and the musicals obviously would reflect this. who else to kind of give us perhaps the quintessential fragmented musical, but Stephen Sondheim. He would do that throughout his career, in fact. But Company was a show that had kind of a circular structure. There was no linear plot that was driving it. It was about whether Robert was thinking he was going to get married or not, that whole question, and his going to five different couples, and you didn't even know if it was his 35th birthday with all these different parties. It was meant to be a little confusing, but there was absolute focus on a thematic issue here, not a plot. So that's one thing that Sondheim wanted to move away from, interestingly enough, because Sondheim had learned how to write the integrated musical from Oscar Hammerstein himself. But now he is moving in a much different way. But the music captures the anxiety of the times. There's a great number called City of Strangers. And if you look at the set that Boris Aronson created for a Company, you see kind of a skeletal world, very much an image of a fragmented society. In fact, I don't know if you can pick it out, but there's two elevators that take people up and down, and you're kind of floating in a very isolated, very alone kind of world there. It's almost harsh. I mean, people loved it because they thought it was so new, the idea of not having to drive it by a plot. But also, pretty much half the audience felt that it was a very cold show. There was nothing warm and kind of comforting about it. So Very interesting approach. This next musical probably shows you a little bit more of the Fragmented Musical. This is the Me Nobody Knows, which was actually written in a community-based way. It was drawn from interviews and writings of young teenagers who were living in Bedford-Stuyvesant in Harlem, writing about their lives. And for most of what Stephen Joseph did, he basically took their words and put them into these songs and dialogue sections. But the Gary Friedman score also reflects a little bit of the dislocation of the lives that they led. What was unique about this show is how popular it became. People who weren't living on the streets like these kids were relating to their stories. So that's another aspect of musicals. The ones that get the attention of the audiences obviously are saying something that is relevant. So here's a little clip. I think you'll get the idea of what a complex, introspective world it is. It's very much about the characters themselves, but very honest, and that's what makes this work so well. So this is from the Me Nobody Knows.
I'm standing up in court. I feel sick to my stomach because I'm scared to death. Then the judge, he looks me up and down, and then asks me a question, so I answer him back. And then finally, after about 15 minutes after he's spoken to my parents, he said I was paroled. Well, then a smile comes to my face, and I leave that courtroom in a hurry. And outside, I jump for joy, because once again, I am free again. Walking the day, walking the night. Count off the time, 1 to 10, till you're free, free again. To walk the world, free as air with your days and your nights, all aglow everywhere you go. Walk without pain.
Next, if you a jumper.
Walk without pain.
Actually a great number, but as you can see, this is a show where the central character are the whole cast of these teenagers. It's not like one person's story. It's not plot driven. In fact, the scenery even tells you that this is very much about the breakup of the American family. They're living in these sheds, these corners of the city. So visually, it's even telling you a story of fragmentation. Follies, Sondheim gets together with James Goldman and writes a show that looks back at the era of the great Follies, the Ziegfeld Follies. But again, very fragmented depictions of characters thinking thoughts in their heads. It's almost like you're going into each character's head to hear the next song. So that's another part of the fragmentation. Godspell did very well, played over 2,500 performances. But again, it's not a parable, a series of parables, or even the storyline, the chronological story of Christ's life. It's more thematically based as to what the next scene is going to be about. And it's obviously more about the point, which is that Jesus is asking us to look inside ourselves. It is very much a reflective musical. And some great songs, obviously, Day by Day, Day by Day. Everyone is singing that song by 1971. Pippin, another example of a kind of fragmented musical. And again, fragmented doesn't mean that there's something wrong with it. It, in fact, is a very sharp insight by Bush Jones that simply is telling us that the musical was moving in a much different direction and very much reflective of what was happening in America at the time. So it's meant to be a positive insight. Pippin is a young man's journey to find, one song called His Corner of the Sky. And Pippin happens to be the son of Charlemagne, so we're going back to medieval times for this. But Stephen Schwartz, who also did the musical for Godspell, followed just months later, doing this with great choreography by Bob Fosse. In fact, in this clip, you're going to see the famous jazz hands that will become a famous item on Broadway. But again, it's kind of fragmented in the way that the story is designed. It's almost thematic the way Pippin unfolds. So here's a little clip of magic to do from Pippin.
Join us, leave your cheese to sour. Join us, come and waste an hour or two. Ah, do-lee-doo, journey, birdie to a spot exciting, mystic and exotic. Journey through our anecdotic view. We've got magic to do just for you. Hearts to football, hearts to war, kings and things to take by storm as we go along our way.
Intrigue, costuming disaster,
humor handled by a master.
Romance, sex, resentment, pastoral.
Ben Vereen was such a great performer, and with Fosse's choreography, it really was such an entertaining show. Pippin, and it still gets many productions today. I want to get you to Chorus Line, which is probably the best example of a fragmented musical, and it really reveals how powerful a fragmented musical could be. But just to get you up to 1975, realize that Grease opens in 1972, and Grease, Jim Jacobs and Warren Casey, try to create a parody of the 1950s, and what they end up doing is creating one of the most nostalgic trips for audiences who just love it and go to 3,500 performances of it. But it is an image of an innocent world apart from the days of Watergate. And a 1978 film becomes very popular. The revival in 1994 did very well. And Grease, in a way, will kick off a whole fascination with nostalgia that we'll see come up more towards the 80s. Meanwhile, a little night music, 1973, is Sondheim and Hal Prince working together. Again, very reflective songs, but it won the best musical, on the Tonys, especially for the wonderful song Send in the Clowns. Beautiful, beautiful song. Rocky Horror Show, 1973, also a trip back to the 1950s, but not in the way that Grease did it. This is America exploring a little bit more of its sexual hang-ups, its excesses, and a look at the sexual revolution. It had started in London, and some say that Rocky Horror created the punk movement in London single-handedly. It came to Los Angeles for 9 months and didn't do well in New York. But the film that came out in 1975, which was a flop, somehow started getting shown at midnight at theaters and created a whole counterculture such that Rocky Horror is still going very strong. So yeah, if you have never seen the film, that's actually a great look at a different kind of nostalgia, Rocky Horror Movie. But Chorus Line is perhaps one of the greatest examples of how a fragmented musical can work. It begins with Michael Bennett interviewing dancers, or gypsies as they're known, people who try to put together a life by going from one show to another, dancing in choruses. And he takes these interviews, and along with Marvin Hamlisch's music and James Kirkwood's storyline, he creates something that is not a storyline at all. In fact, it's just a look at all the different dancers and what they're going through in the process of trying to make it on Broadway. You're looking at a backstage musical, as we looked at in the 1920s, remember? Probably the the best one ever. And it will become the longest running Broadway show until, of course, things like Phantom show up. But here's a little clip that will show you just how powerful Chorus Line was for many peoples, not just dancers, obviously. So this is I need this job from Chorus Line.
By the early 70s, New York City, like the rest of America, was in a deep recession. And nowhere was that more evident than on the Great White Way.
This area in the 70s was a sewer. This was the den of pornography, prostitution, felony crime, drug dealing, you name it.
What Broadway needed was a hit. This time, it would come not from a big-time star, but from the supporting cast, the dancers, the self-titled gypsies who provided the backbone of a musical.
Of course, dancers on Broadway are blue-collar workers. It's a life commitment, and it's something that either you have inside of you and you have to do it, or maybe you should go sell hamburgers instead, because it's not for sissies, contrary to popular belief.
It was a former gypsy who reinvigorated Broadway, making dance so popular that leg warmers became a fashion statement. Michael D'Ofelia first appeared in a touring company of West Side Story, but on Broadway, he became known as Michael Bennett.
I met Michael on Hullabaloo, a TV variety show, 1964. One day, we're dancing side by side and we're bringing the jerk to new heights. And I say, Michael, what are you gonna do when you grow up? You can't keep doing this the rest of your life. Did you ever think of that, huh? And he said, yes, I'm gonna be a choreographer. And I went, oh, good luck. Don't forget about me.
Bennett got his first job choreographing on Broadway in 1966. He went on to stage dance numbers in Company and, with Hal Prince, co-directed Sondheim's next musical, Follies. In 1973, Bennett began to work on his own show. Without any pre-existing story, he held a series of workshops where he tape-recorded dancers talking about their experiences.
When we started a Chorus Line, it was called The Dancers Project, and it was a secret. We would start every day with a blank page, and our lives were a part of the process.
You know, this was the first time there was such a thing as a workshop. And we were young guys, and we were all just desperate to put on something very special, very new. All we talked about is, let's do something on Broadway like they've never seen before.
Again, step, kick, kick.
With backing from Joseph Papp, Bennett spent an unprecedented 18 months developing the musical. A plot line emerged about dancers auditioning for a part in a new show.
Becca next week, turn, turn, out, in, jump, step, step, kick, kick, leap, kick, touch. Got it? Going on. A 5, 6, 7, 8, a turn, turn, touch.
In the beginning, there was a very difficult balance between making this about dancers but not making this about dancers.
A 5, 6, 7, 8, a turn, turn, touch, down.
At what point can you get away from the dancer metaphor and get into the world of we're all on a line? We're all in this together.
Who am I? anyway? Am I my resume? So many faces all around, and here we go. I need this job. Oh God, I need this show.
That did not happen until one day in rehearsal that Michael Bennett took a chalk and went wham and drew a line on the floor. And he said, that's the line. We're all on the line. Well, now the common denominator of all these people is, God, I hope I get it. I hope I get it. With da 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 da.
Everyone has dreams and hopes, and there was something in that show for everybody. Men who are just retired would write me letters and say, your character made me go out and start a new business. Football players would say, the line. They would talk about the line, being on the line.
Most dramatically, for the show's finale, Bennett transformed a classic Broadway kick line into a bittersweet comment on the life of a dancer.
An entire, you know, 2 hours talking about these individual people and that all this torture they have to go through to get a job, to be on Broadway, is to be in an assembly line. That was the genius of Michael. He gave the audience what they expected. What he meant was something else.
And it helped to revolutionize Broadway itself. It was about Broadway, and it brought people out to want to not just hear about what was going on backstage, but what was going on in their own lives. It's amazing how compelling Chorus Line turns out to be for individual people, as McKechnie was just saying. Football players and retired businessmen found something relevant with Chorus Line. And perhaps it was because it was a fragmented musical. You were looking inside people. And to some extent, do you relate better when it's a storyline that you can follow, or whether you're going deeply into a person's own specific problems and you somehow can relate to that? So the idea of these introspective musicals that we talk about in terms of the fragmented musical, maybe that is an important part of the musical. It certainly will now filter into musicals from now on. So it was a new innovation, perhaps, rather than just a momentary phase. So yes, the fragmented musical. Meanwhile, just 3 months later, Chicago opens in 1975, and this is a fabulous Bob Fosse. This is probably Bob Fosse's definitive musical, based on a play that was written in the 1920s. Maureen Watkins wrote it, and it later went to a film in 1940s, or Roxy Hart. and Gwen Verdon, who was, you know, eager to be in it and have her husband Bob Fosse direct it, kind of stalked Maureen Watkins to try to get her to allow them to make it into a musical. And that did not happen until 1975. But fabulous performance. And in a strange way, it made people think about the impact of the media on our life and how it tends to celebrate criminals and perhaps desensitize us to domestic violence. It's all based on a story about a woman who actually did kill her husband. The musical goes even further in kind of glamorizing it, in the same way they talked about how gangs were glamorized in West Side Story. So there were a lot of complaints about this, but Chicago has done very well, and its later revival was even more popular in the 90s. Stephen Sondheim then turns around and does, in 1976, the bicentennial year, Pacific Overtures, which is a wonderful musical, and he did it from a whole Japanese perspective of the opening up of Japan with the visit by Commodore Perry in 1853, And the sets that Tony Stragis and Aronson created were quite wonderful, all based with kabuki style that Hal Prince directed. However, it was something of an anti-American statement, and coming in the bicentennial year of 1976, it was just bad timing. Sondheim has a tendency to have bad timings for his shows, as we'll see, especially when he does Assassins. But what America really needed in 1977 was a pick-me-up musical that could make me feel positive, and that's exactly what Martin Sharnan decided to do when he went back to Harold Gray's Little Orphan Annie and made a musical using Charles Strauss, his music, and Thomas Meehan wrote the book. Annie became a way of giving America a little faith that tomorrow was going to be better. So it's very interesting how Annie was so successful at the time because it provided something that people really needed. This was a feel-good musical as we looked at back in the Depression years. In fact, Annie, the time zone for that, is in the Depression years. A number of other musicals, Runaways, Elizabeth Swatos was a unique experiment where she looked at some of the problems that homeless teens were having, and it all comes down to a kind of accusation against the parents, which didn't make it a very positive image. Working with Stephen Schwartz again, doing music with a number of other people based on Studs Terkel's wonderful, wonderful book that portrays America at work, did very well, especially at college and regional venues. So Working, 1978. And then something that was certainly not a fragmented musical, and in fact reflects an entirely new public that comes to theater for perhaps the first time, was in 1978, what happened out here at the LA Mark Taper Forum, when Gordon Davidson had a literal riot on his hand when he did Zoot Suit. Now, Zoot Suit was written by Luis Valdez, the man who had worked with Cesar Chavez in the 1965 grape strike, to use theater to help promote the strike itself. Valdez, by this time, 1978, wanted to do something that was going to popularize what Latinos were going through. So he used the famous story of the Sleepy Lagoon case, where some 20 Chicano youths back in the 1940s were sent to prison for a murder that they did not do. And he created Zoot Suit, which was a reflection of the styles that were worn then that very much identified Chicano youth. And there was a lot of violence in the 40s when you'd have sailors from San Diego going into barrios and beating up Chicano youths who were dressed like Edward James almost was. Let me show you a little clip so you get an idea of the kind of spirit that was there. It went to a feature-length movie. It also went to Broadway. Didn't do too well on Broadway. There's a different Latino connection in New York than out here with the Mexican-American populace who just... Supposedly, 250,000 people saw this show at the Taper out here when it played in 78. So this is a little clip from Zoot Suit. This is from the movie.
Cuando salgo yo a bailar, yo me pongo muy catrín. Las guisitas gritan, vamos a bailar el swing. Sabrosón, se alborota el corazón y con una chavalona vamos a bailar el mambo. De los bailes que me inventé, el bolero y el biguín, de todos los bailes juntos. Me gusta bailar el swing.
Valdez did a very interesting thing. The character that Edward James Olmos plays is the Pachuco, which is kind of a mythological character who serves as an alter ego in the story. It's not necessarily a fragmented piece. We've had a lot of plays that feature a character who comes in, no one else can see, but the central character, in this case, is actually played by his brother, Danny Valdez. But it provided insights about how Latinos were treated, and very much a kind of prideful look at Latino culture. So a first in the mid-70s. At this time, also 1979, we get Sweeney Todd. Now we're going to spend the second half of today's broadcast on looking at Sweeney Todd, and there you see how Prince talking to Stephen Sondheim, a very unique musical that does fit into the fragmentation era that we're talking about, with characters going into long kind of songs about themselves, and it's obviously somewhat fragmented when you consider that you have people being chopped up into little pieces and put into pies. So there's certainly a fragmentation happening there. But as we go into the 80s, another interesting development happens with the American musical, where nostalgia plays a very important part. Nostalgia, Bush Jones refers to it as longing for an earlier era, indicate that people are discontented with the present. And whether it's the horrible Challenger disaster that happened, or Wall Street corruption, or the sex scandals, we have some violence like the bombing at Oklahoma City, the Waco fiasco, and then later things like Columbine. America needed to go to a place, remember in the 40s and 50s when we talked about a utopia, there needed to be something of a a safe place. Of course, many Americans went to alcohol and to drugs and into depression, but the need for escape entertainment was even promoted by our president to some extent, Ronald Reagan. We have an actor, a former governor of California, who in a way helps promote a little bit more of a 50s style. And this was a time that Stephen Sondheim talked about how we live in a recycled culture, that we are looking at TV reruns. We are listening to the oldies but goodies on our radio programs. So we're going to get Broadway provide our first round of revivals, bringing back shows like Showboat. And we're going to get retro reviews where we'll pick a singer or a composer like Frank Lesser or Gershwin and do a whole musical based around their music. Or sometimes pop reviews where you'll take something like Buddy Holly or Duke Ellington and take their music and make a play out of it, a musical play out of it. The 1940s Radio Hour is a perfect example, which is a wonderful show. It takes place in a radio station during the war years, 1943-44, and you get to see actually the sound effects that are created for some of the bits that are done on radio, but you get to hear these Frank Sinatra-like characters singing great old Cole Porter songs. So America becomes fascinated with nostalgia and wants to kind of go back. Now, this all really began with 42nd Street. David Merrick, who was fondly called the abominable showman because of his almost persistent arrogance at promoting his shows, he helped perhaps set off this nostalgia craze by taking a Busby Berkeley movie musical from 1932, 42nd Street, and making it into a show. And it was a blockbuster. It really worked quite well. Songs like Lullaby of Broadway, and this actually brought Jerry Orbach to play the lead character. And he was quite a singer, dancer at the time. So, and with Gower Champion's wonderful choreography, it helped popularize the idea of bringing back shows. Some shows like Tintypes were original plays. This was done in 1980, but it was a retro review of songs from the turn of the century. So you got to hear songs like Shine On, Harvest Moon, literally 1910, 1911. And five actors basically did all the different characters. So it was a unique play, but it was based on kind of bringing us back to a more nostalgic type. And the idea of going to a world that was a much safer world was most clearly revealed in Cats. So this is Andrew Lloyd Webber, who had for many years wanted to create a sense of kind of Italian opera conventions, but put them into more modern rock styles. And Lloyd Webber was very successful with doing that with Joseph and the Amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat in 1968, probably more successful with Jesus Christ Superstar, which became a very popular album long before it became an actual stage show. But we'll see Tommy, the rock opera, go to stage as well. But a lot of his work, like Evita, for instance, in 78 with Hal Prince, where he took Eva Perón from Argentina and put her into a more pop format, he wanted to do this as well with T.S. Eliot's famous book, Old Possum's Book of Practical Cats. So it's based on a poem, a number of poems about cats. They went to Hal Prince and kind of pitched it to him, and he just didn't understand what they were talking about, so he passed on it. And that's when they went to Cameron McIntosh and Trevor Nunn, who directed it. But it was basically a review format with these wonderful cat outfits and fabulous makeup and Gillian Lynn's fantastic choreography. And of course, John Napier does this amazing scenic world where everything is magnified, made larger. So you have this huge tire on which Grisabella sits and ascends like into kitty heaven at the end. And of course, wonderful songs that also made it very popular. But it helped establish pop music on Broadway and ran for 18 years and became the first of what Bush Jones also calls the techno musicals, where you're really fascinated with the technicalities of how things are done, and you're not looking for a story, and there certainly is no story in Cats. It fits into our fragmented format very well. Meanwhile, some unique new plays, like March of the Falsettos, 1981, which was really the first successful musical that depicted a gay male relationship. Now, there had been many plays like Boys in the Band, 1968, a number of other plays. Harvey Fierstein had written Torch Song Trilogy, but never do we get a musical. And Falsettos was very unique for the character of Marvin, who is married and has a child, but then discovers that he's gay. So he tries to create this unique new family. And it had a number of different versions that were written all the way into the 90s. So, William Finn, with the help of Jim Lapine, who would later work with Stephen Sondheim as well. Nine is a unique musical. We start finding now that Broadway is going to look at former films as an idea, just as David Merrick did with 42nd Street. Now the idea of taking a Fellini film, 8 1/2, and letting Arthur Kopit do a version where adapted by Mario Frati, we now have Raul Julia performing the stage version of what had been a famous Fellini movie. So, and it worked, especially with some of the fabulous choreography and music that was done by Maury Yeston. So Nine, unique. But one of perhaps the best of the nostalgic musicals, this all began with Grease, admittedly, but Little Shop of Horrors, 1982, became a very unique offering that never went to Broadway. It actually was very happy staying off Broadway. Of course, it becomes a major film later, but this is based on Roger Corman's somewhat horrendous B-grade movie from the 1950s about a plant that starts eating everybody. Luckily, you had music written by Alan Menken, who would write so many wonderful Disney movies later, and Howard Ashman's lyrics and book really made this into quite a unique story with some great songs like Somewhere That's Green, which is a real look back at a 50s style world, but done with obviously a sense of satire. I have a little clip here that shows you from the film the opening sequence, which is quite wonderful. You have these three narrators in the film who are basically kind of like the Supremes. So they're dealing with you face on, but the most of the show is pretty plot driven, but it is a wonderful look at the nostalgic look at the 50s. So this is the 1986 film that Frank Oz made, but this is the opening of Little Shop of Horrors.
Little
It's really a wonderful stage play. They did a very good job with the film, but the stage play, it gets a lot of productions. It's difficult to do because you need four different plants of much larger sizes, as Audrey gets to be, Audrey 2 gets to be life size. And another unique thing about this musical, in the film, of course, the Hollywood ending, they blow it up and save Ellen Green and Rick Moranis, and they live their life in Levittown or wherever. But in the stage version, the plant wins. And if you saw the off-Broadway production, tendrils come down the sides of the theaters, and Audrey too starts coming out to the audience. Audrey eats everybody at the end and is about to get the audience. So, major difference from the film version. If you ever get a chance to see the stage version, go and see it. You'll really love it. So, nostalgia. And it was there in Do Patent Leather Shoes Really Reflect Up? 1982. Obviously, a fascination with parochial school, as was the 1985 production of Nonsense by Dan Goggin, which was a look at singing nuns, but very much a kind of feeling of nostalgia in that show. I have an interesting comment on our discussion board by Mark Uyehara, who wrote, in Chapter 9, Jones talks about 1970s reflecting signs of nostalgia with musicals containing 1950s themes and simplicity like Grease, Peter Pan, Little Shop of Horrors. It is interesting that beginning January 2013, the California Department of Motor Vehicles has been offering personalized gold and black 1950s, 1960s, and 1970s license plates. What do you make of that? Do we all unconsciously have the desire for a simpler life? That was done very well, Mark. Our fascination is, it's not a negative thing at all. We do want things to be simpler, and that perhaps is wonderfully expressed when we still listen to songs from the 1950s, perhaps. So very good insight there. I don't know if La Cage aux Folles was necessarily a nostalgic look, but it obviously went back to a film that had been very popular in the 60s. Actually, it was a French play that first began it, but then it was made into a movie in the 70s, and that became the source of Harvey Fierstein writing the libretto with Jerry Herman on a rather unique production. It at least gave us a rather enjoyable love story between two men, Georges and Albin, but it gets into quite a farcical element by the end of it. But this is a little clip from La Cage aux Folles.
We are what we are, and what we are is an illusion.
Herman wrote both music and lyrics for Hello Dolly and Mame, and he brought his mastery of old-fashioned fun and flamboyance to the glitzy French drag club where La Cage aux Folles was set.
I went to Jerry Herman's apartment, listened to the score, and I said to him, we'll do this show. I thought the music was beautiful. Probably one of the best scores ever written.
Adapted from a French film, La Cage aux Folles had a conventional musical comedy structure. But there was nothing conventional about its romantic couple.
I made it all about love. This was a couple that had been together for 20-something years. This was the real loving married couple.
Do you recall that windy little beach we walked along?
When we were previewing in Boston, I was very, very nervous about the subject matter. And I said to Harvey Fierstein and Arthur Lawrence, who were huddled with me in the last row of the theater, I said, you know, we're crazy. We're opening the show about transvestites in the city of Boston. We're really crazy.
As we walked on the sand.
It was the first time on the Broadway stage that two men sang a love song to each other.
Through the crash of the waves, I could tell that the words were romantic.
This was a show that in the beginning, when all these guys in drag came out on stage, The men who'd been dragged to see it by their wives covered their faces. At the end of the show, they were standing up and cheering two men dancing off into the sunset. I thought that was quite an accomplishment.
Gay sensibility was always in the theater, but whether we got seen by large groups of people or not is the difference. And this is America, and unless you can make money, it don't count. So, La Cage aux Folles, hardly the first gay musical on Broadway, but the first gay musical to make money, and that's what makes it count.
I think it was a groundbreaking show, and I think it would have been more successful had there not been the AIDS scare at that time.
I am what I am. I am my own special creation.
AIDS. It cut a devastating swath through the talent pool on Broadway. Michael Bennett and Ron Field comes to mind. So many people that worked on Broadway that are gone.
We lost an entire generation of musical theater. You know, if musical theater is gay men, and for the most part it is, we lost an entire generation. We lost our children, you know, we lost our youth.
People who might have become famous, a dancer like Tim Scott, just a brilliant supporting performer like Rene Clemente, you know, not the great names that people go, oh my God, what the Broadway theater lost because he died, but so many people from the ranks. The thing about AIDS, it didn't just get the generals. It got the privates. It got the guys in the trenches.
In response to the AIDS crisis, the company of La Cage aux Folles and others from the Broadway community created Broadway Cares Equity Fights AIDS, which has raised over $65 million to help people suffering from the disease.
Life's not worth a damn.
At the end of that song, he takes his wig off and throws it. Not in anger, but in kind of a celebration of being able to stand up finally. I'm delighted they went into the AIDS crisis too, that just was so horrible during the 80s. And we lost so many talented people. So it was a galvanizing production, La Cage aux Folles, and it's done very well since. I saw it in Long Beach, a wonderful production out here. Complicated to do because it involves a lot of different sets. It's quite glamorous. So it's an entertaining show in every respect. Meanwhile, the nostalgic craze throughout American musicals in the early 80s, like Sugar Babies, which was a look at the old burlesque world, kind of helped kind of promote that, though. You actually had Ann Miller coming back with Mickey Rooney involved in that. My One and Only was a look at the Gershwin's music. This was a retro review that was created of theater songs. Frank Rich called it a wonderful spin down memory lane, but it did feature Tommy Toon and Twiggy, there they are, dancing quite wonderfully for over 700 performances. But then Stephen Sondheim does take something of a nostalgic trip by working with Jim Lapine on going back into the 19th century to look at the world of Georges Seurat, who was a pointillist painter. And Jim Lapine wanted to look at this famous painting, A Sunday Afternoon on the Island of Le Grand Jeté, where all the characters in this painting do not look at each other. And that's one thing that Sondheim and Lapine wanted to kind of explore. Why aren't they? So in the process, they create this wonderful musical, Sunday in the Park with George, 1984, which was just a vivid look at the art world, and it was something of an art piece itself. You'll see in this little clip we have Mandy Patinkin, who is, as Georges Seurat, painting this famous painting, and he has Bernadette Peters playing the character of Dot, which they actually came up with that name for her. But a very unique situation as he's painting her, how she is trying to express her feelings for him. So this is from Sunday in the Park with George.
George, why is it you always get to sit in the shade while I have to stand in the sun? George? Hello, George. There is someone in this dress. A trickle of sweat. The back of the head. He always does this. Now the foot is dead. Sunday in the park with George, one more. The collar is damp, beginning to pinch. The bustle's slipping, I won't budge one inch. Who was at the zoo, George? Who was at the zoo? The monkeys and who, George? The monkeys and who?
Don't move, please.
Artists are bizarre, fixed, cold. That's you, George, you're bizarre.
Wonderful, inventive take on what may have been happening in that actual famous painting. And then in the second act, they actually return to modern times, and we get a different version of George. I think it's his grandson or another relation of his that is promoting a more modern art event. So very unique look at the art world by Jim Lapine and Stephen Sondheim. There's a lot of new voices and new perspectives that happen throughout the 80s and 90s. And as with Le Cage aux Folles, we start getting shows that are about women, about homosexuals, about blacks, about the marginalized peoples in America, and it is very much a reflection of what is happening at that time. And quite honestly, I think 1980, America didn't know where it was going to go dramatically, and shows became more anthropological, started looking at people and their histories, and it was a very unique development in theater, such that in the 80s and 90s, it somewhat revitalized and brought new ideas into the musicals, even though we talk about the techno musical, for instance. But a lot of wonderful musicals like A My Name is Alice, which was a kind of a kaleidoscope look at women and in the workforce, was done at the American Place Theater in New York. Quilters was another one that looked at pioneer women, the story of Sarah and her six daughters as they're moving across the West. Very much very popular in regional theaters as well. It came from actually the Denver Center Theater, but a kind of patchwork structure, similar to what Sondheim had done in Sunday in the Park with George, where the music actually reflected the, in the pointillistic case of Georges Seurat, a kind of series of dots and shapes. Quilters does a very similar thing in the way that it shapes together the different stories of the women. But it, in a way, perhaps represents the last of the fragmented musicals at that time. Because what comes into play now are what Bush Jones calls the techno musicals. And Les Mis was perhaps the first one, although as he speaks about in the book, there's a lot of great storytelling that goes on here. This is Victor Hugo's famous novel from the 19th century in Les Miserables. But what Alain Bobreuil does with the libretto, and what Claude-Michel Schoenberg does, which is almost like Leonard Bernstein type of music, very elevating, and very powerful. The simple story of a convict, Jean Valjean, who is pursued by this Inspector Javert for breaking his parole, and he actually manages to adopt Cosette, who becomes something of the logo for the show. Cameron Mackintosh, very smart in his marketing campaigns. But The libertarian theme was what made this so popular with audiences. It wasn't about the French Revolution, but many kind of made that connection. It was actually about a student uprising in 1832. But perhaps what made it the techno musical is what John Napier did with this wonderful turntable. You'll see it from this clip. This is how Trevor Nunn directed the show to really kind of masterfully handle the idea of turning sets on stage. So this is a wonderful clip that'll show that from Les Misérables. Of course, Andrew Lloyd Webber wanted to get into the act as well, and his Starlight Express, which followed the next year, 1987, was a very unique work by John Napier, who had done Cats with him, and created a marvelous scene of characters as kind of like train figures on skates. So it was a unique techno musical of sorts. But of course, before we take a break, I have to give you a little clip from Phantom of the Opera, which is, of course, not only the all-time greatest of the techno musicals, but the longest-running musical on Broadway. We just looked it up. It's 10,965 shows of Phantom of the Opera. And that's not to say that it's only because of the chandelier that drops at the end of the first act, the story being that Eric is a jealous ghost, and when he falls in love with Christine, he gets very jealous of her love for Raoul. He'll let them stay together at the end, but at the end of the first act, he has this chandelier crash on stage. But I think what makes it really wonderful techno musical is this great scene where you see the Phantom bringing Christine in into his lair, and the wonderful candlelights coming up out of the foggy grotto there that they're paddling through. So this is a little clip from Phantom of the Opera. This features Michael Crawford and Sarah Brightman from Phantom.
Michael Crawford and Sarah Brightman in The Phantom of the Opera.
In all your fantasies, you are
music.
You know, I have to, before we take the break, I just want to share with you some comments that our students made about how Phantom represents something that people really want. Just calling it a techno musical is not necessarily trying to put it down. As we talked about with the Fragmented Musicals or with the nostalgic craze, it's what motivates people to go to see a show. It takes them perhaps on a Disney-type ride. And, you know, we looked at the utopias of the 1940s and 50s, and there's something very necessary about it. And I think you'll agree when you read, for instance, this is Linda Holmes writing about it. The techno musicals of the 80s and 90s, like Phantom, often get criticized by diehard theater files and others who view them as too pedestrian. That was very well put, too, Linda. Critics editorialize the Great White Way has been invaded by tourists who want a theme park experience and don't really share the love of the foundation of musical theater. While I understand that these large productions have taken more than their fair share of the marketplace and left little room for the startup production to succeed, I would counter that the beginnings of musical theater in America were never about original work or true artistic merit. Remember, the opera house was the place for the rich and highbrow. The musical theater was always about entertaining the lower classes. Pinafore mania blazed through New York, not because it was high art, but because the audience found it understandable and whimsical, even that if the understanding was incorrect to the creator's vision. Very good point about Pinafore. The success of The Black Crow was precursor to a mega success of Phantom. Americans have always wanted dancing candlesticks and teapots. It just couldn't be done until the present day. Sorry, that's The Black Crook, actually, is the show that you're referring to, 1860s. But that's okay, because it's very much the point that you're making. If we have learned anything from this class, it is that the American musical is constantly changing and the pendulum will probably swing back the other way, and we may find ourselves gravitating back to works with more social significance. It's already true with works like Rent, Spring Awakening, and Book of Mormon, for one thing, is always true. The critics never get to make the choice. It's the audience who decides, and the theater is only a reflection of the public's appetite. I think that's wonderful, Linda. Very much a statement of how the American musical is a reflection of America, though some critics have helped to hurt shows to keep running. They do have a lot of power in New York. I agree with you that there's many critics who didn't like Cats, but people came out to see it in droves, as with Phantom of the Opera. So the techno musical does say something about America, something very important. And finally, I just want to, before we break, Jennifer Tercios agrees with her and says, the 1980s were the years of big hair, shoulder pads, and bright colors. There was nothing subtle about it, so I am not surprised that the 1980s produced some of the major mega musicals or techno musicals, as Jones puts it, such as Cats, Les Mis, and Phantom. These shows are known for their grandeur and special effects. There was criticism about the effects taking away substance from the musical as Americans had come to know. The stage flair did bring in more money, so unfortunately for those critics, most of these mega musicals are well known and had fairly long runs. Yes, the proof of the pudding is if it makes money and more people come to see it. And Bush Jones actually says that in his first chapter too, that that's what is a successful show, if it sells tickets. Harvey Fierstein just said the same thing. Well, listen, glad we finally got around to talking to the techno musical, but let's take a break before we look at Sweeney Todd. So hopefully you'll join us and look at Stephen Sondheim's very unique late 70s musical, Sweeney Todd.
You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills. We'll be right back.
Hi, I'm Bruce Betts, Director of Projects for the Planetary Society, and I'm here at Planetary Society headquarters in Pasadena, California, talking to you about the Young Scholars Program and my introduction to planetary science and astronomy class at California State University Dominguez Hills. One of the main things Planetary Society does is educate and inspire the public about space and space exploration.
So science education is the key to our future, not just California, not just the United States, but the world. And I'm not kidding, because we have enormous problems to solve around the world. And to understand them and to solve them, we're going to need scientists and engineers. And this is what the Planetary Society does, is get people excited about science through space. We try to advance space science and exploration, really, for the betterment of all humankind. And it all adds up. So Cal State Dominguez Hills is part of that.
I've been a guest at the Cal State Dominguez Hills distance learning classes and been able to talk about my research on Venus and Mars, but also on all of the really cool research that's being done on planets all over the solar system by the active missions that are out there right now. I think that it's really fun to be able to share the adventure of exploring the solar system with audience, with all different kinds of people coming from all different places, whether they're adults or kids, current students, or people who were last students a long time ago.
In the case of this class, to be able to actually not only reach out to new audiences, but provide detail information and really share what is an inherently visual type of science, planetary science, with TV.
At Cal State Dominguez Hills, like at any university, our primary mission is to educate students. Through the Young Scholars Program, we at CSUDH are partnering with the Planetary Society to get high school students from around the state of California interested in science and careers in science even before they enter college. In so doing, we stay involved with our local community and make opportunities available to these students that they might not otherwise get.
So Cal State Dominguez Hills is part of that.
Hi, my name is Obi Wogboy, and I'm currently a junior at California State University Dominguez Hills. The reason I came to this school was for the great environment, the small class sizes, and the amazing sociology program.
Iron Chef 6!
Amazing.
This is good. I think they rose to the occasion.
Dude, love, love, love. Brother, love. That Mandarin sauce is ridiculous.
The heat was fantastic. I enjoyed the flavors.
Our champion is the Literals.
We're passing out information for all the parents that come in, so we're letting them know where the workshops are, what time, and where to, what to find inside the gym.
My name is Alberto Mieri Terán. I'm the Senior Vice President and General Manager of the Univision Los Angeles television stations. We have a beautiful partnership with Cal State Dominguez Hills and the Cal State University School System, in which we have partnered up to do what I consider, I'm a little biased, the best educational fair in the country. Fifth year of working with Cal State Dominguez Hills, and it's been absolutely a wonderful success story in the fact that every year it grows, it gets better. It's a huge resource to the community, to both the surrounding community in Carson and to the Latino community.
So it's really, really exciting that we are
trying to increase like the amount of students that go into college.
Hello, my name is Maria Rosales. I'm a senior at California State University, Dominguez Hills. I'm majoring in Criminal Justice Administration. The reason why I decided to come to this campus was for its great faculty, great location, and friendly environment.
Enrich your life. Increase your earning potential. Cal State Dominguez Hills offers a master's degree in humanities. With a focus on the cities of the world, this master's degree can be earned in as little as 5 semesters. Evening classes are available for your convenience. Why wait? Call 310-243-3636. That's 310-243-3636.
Alberto Mieriterán. I'm the Senior Vice President and General Manager of the Univision Los Angeles television stations. We have a beautiful partnership with Cal State Dominguez Hills and the Cal State University school system, in which we have partnered up to do what I consider, I'm a little biased, the best educational fair in the country. Fifth year of working with Cal State Dominguez Hills, and it's been absolutely a wonderful success story in the fact that every year it grows, it gets better. It's a huge resource to the community, to both the surrounding community in Carson and to the Latino community.
So it's really, really exciting that we are trying to increase like the amount of students that go into college.
Watching DHTV, the broadcast program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi everyone, Bill DeLuca back at the American Musical, and today we're going to look in our second half here at Sweeney Todd, a work by Stephen Sondheim, who wrote the music and the lyrics, with a libretto by Hugh Wheeler, and where he took a 1973 play that was written by Christopher Bond and transformed it into this wonderful story of Benjamin Barker, who is Sweeney Todd, who is returns from London after 15 years of being deported on a trumped-up charge by this judge. So he comes back and finds out that the judge had raped his wife, who has killed herself, and he vows revenge against the judge and later the whole world. And he teams up with this pie maker, Mrs. Lovett, and they end up taking the dead bodies and munching them into meat pies. So a very grotesque concept for a musical. Perhaps that's what qualifies it as a fragmented musical, just the idea of what happens to these bodies. Actually, I had a wonderful comment by William Grievous on our discussion board, who wrote, "As was central to most of the fragmented musicals of this period, the theme of alienation from society was prevalent in Sweeney Todd. Todd's banishment to a prison island alienated him from his family and his community, causing him to lose touch with himself. Todd's betrayal by the system and by those who run it, Judge Turpin and Beadle Bamford, forces him to take desperate action into his own hands. Todd no longer could trust the government institution that was supposed to protect him from the atrocities he was experiencing." And that's what made it very much an American reflection of the time, that people felt this dislocation, this intense kind of alienation from having any say anymore. So that frustration was there in Sweeney as the character, and it made people cheer for him, even though he is a murderer in the play. So, very unusual character who perhaps is more of a tragic character in the classical sense of revenge tragedies, which is certainly what this is. And I want to also show you this opening clip, but one of the unique things about this show, it was made into a movie by Tim Burton and done very, very well with Johnny Depp and Helena Bonham Carter. It was actually quite lovely, done in 2007 with wonderful, wonderful costumes. But the distinction between watching a film version of a musical and the actual stage musical is immense. And that's why this is the first example I've actually shown of the class of a stage version. So what you're seeing right now is the Hal Prince staging that was done in 1979 at the Eurus Theater in New York. And it features, you've got Angela Lansbury here, although Len Carreyrou did the original role of Sweeney. This is George Hearn doing it. But what you're going to see here is a filmed version of a stage play. And it is a huge difference between being able to come in and do a close-up and be able to do a lot of post-production editing. But I think you'll see perhaps the power of what this musical meant to be. Sondheim talked about it being a horror musical that he wanted to see if he could scare a modern audience. So I'll be curious to see if this clip that we're going to show you of the opening is something that is scary. Just wanted to comment, though. Mark Uyahara made an interesting comment about the difference between film and stage. "At first, I was a little disappointed that we didn't get to watch the film version, the Tim Burton version. But as I watched the musical, I became more intrigued with the original stage version. I found the sets and lighting to be very effective in supporting the darkness of the story. Everything was somewhat veiled, forcing the audience to think about the subtle messages in every scene. That is what is unique about a stage version. An audience keeps its mind and thinks about what's going on rather than just follow the story blindly. I think watching the actual stage version of any musical would cause appreciation from the audience. In a live performance, there's no time for retakes or perfect fancy sets as in movies. I believe the stage actors have a heavier burden to prove the validity of the musical to make the story real. Movies have time to edit and digitally change sets and lighting." And that does hint at how different it is for a performer in a live performance in front of an audience than to be able to take 27 takes until we get it right. So thank you, Mark, for realizing that uniqueness. And I think you'll get a little sense of the kind of performance quality that comes from a live performance in at least this opening clip here. Tell me if you think there was a sense of frightening an audience in this opening clip from Sweeney Todd.
Attend the tale of Sweeney Todd. His skin was pale and his eye was hard. He shaved the faces of gentlemen who never thereafter were heard of again. He trod a path that few have trod, did Sweeney Todd, the demon barber of Fleet Street. He kept a shop in London town, of fancy clients and good renown.
And what if none of their souls were saved? They went to their maker impeccably shaved. By Sweeney Todd, the demon barber of Fleet Street. A love, a bow, and a fancy chair. A mug of such and a leather strop, an apron, a towel, a pail, and a mop.
For deep as he deserved the nod, did Sweeney Todd.
A demon barber of Fleet Street.
Inconspicuous Sweeney was, quick and quiet and clean he was. Back of his smile, under his words, Sweeney heard music that nobody heard. Sweeney Todd!
Attend the tale of Sweeney Todd. He served a dark and avengeful god. What happened then? Well, that's the play, and he wouldn't want us to give it away. Not Sweeney. Not Sweeney Todd. The demon barber of Fleet Street.
Why a chorus? You notice all of the characters are in this opening scene and they all face you. When that happens in a play, it's almost like the audience is aware that they're supposed to react or something, or they're supposed to be listening more intently. It gets right to you. It's in your face. And that happens. The company serves as the narrator of the show, giving us some details about the plot throughout. So there's that element that is a bit scary. You can't just like let the lights go down and you just disappear for 2 hours and just follow it passively. It puts you a little on the edge of your seat. Musically, he's doing the same thing. Sweeney, Sweeney, Sweeney. I mean, he has a lot of uses that are very staccato, sharp edges. Sharp edges. I mean, that's what Sweeney is. He's a barber who slits necks. The music is right there saying what's going on in the story. So there's something of an integrated musical there. Also, scenically, I don't know how well you could see it, but I was at this original production, and the Eurus Theater is a huge, huge theater. And what they did was they actually brought in items from an old factory to create a sense of an industrialized London, mid-19th century, specifically to create the feeling that people in this world were very small, very insignificant. And that showed in that opening section there. And that's a lot of what the play is attempting to do and why it is very much a reflection of America at the time. People did not feel, as William was suggesting, that they were part of the system anymore, that they were alienated from their own work. And people got to be so frustrated, and that's what this story is about. People could grow to a point of being so frustrated that they would take desperate action. Sondheim would follow up and write Assassins about people who actually went out to assassinate presidents. But looking at the violence that we see in the news almost every day in America now, shootings that seem almost random, the look at the frustration that drives people to do that may be perhaps hidden in something like this, which makes it doubly frightening because it's a reflection on violence in our own society. he draws a lot of humor in this show, as we'll see now, but it is very, very dark. And lyrics like, You can go to your maker impeccably shaved. There's a sense of humor there. It's not the kind of humor you're going to laugh at heartily. It's a very sardonic type of humor. So yes, the darkness of Sweeney Todd is not your typical musical, that's for sure, but it was a unique reflection of the time. Let's look at another clip, and I want you to take special notice to the staging here. This is not like in the film, where you can actually have a real boat floating on real water right down the Thames River. Now, notice how they enter Anthony and Todd after this 15 years where he's been kind of imprisoned in Australia. So this is the entrance of Anthony and Todd.
Beheld its wonders, from the Dardanelles to the mountains of Peru. But there's no place like London. I feel home again. I could hear the city bells ring, whatever I would do. No, there's no place like London.
Mr. Todd, sir?
You are young. Life has been kind to you. You will learn. It is here we go our several ways. Farewell, Anthony.
Isn't that great? They bring him in a boat, but it's a stagehand who's actually working a pulley, bringing him in. So you get a little sense that there's a seamanship going on. But you obviously can see the stagehand, and that's going to work throughout the entire show. That's what makes this stage version so unique. Hal Prince wanted you to know that you were in a theater. He didn't want to disguise it all and make it happen like magic. He wanted you to be backstage. It was to create a more precise awareness of what was going on around you. So it's almost like putting a mirror up in the audience. Remember, this is the same Hal Prince who did Cabaret. So he's kind of creating an analogous situation, again, with the kind of alienation of mid-19th century London, but how it applies to America now. So he wants an audience to be able to think. So he's not going to pull magical disguises. He's going to let you see all the stage mechanics. And that's what makes it a very unique musical. Anthony comes in and he hands the lantern to a stagehand. But that wasn't disruptive. It didn't mess our kind of concentration on what was going on. So it's another added element to this, and the idea of having a chorus continually addressing you. In this scene, we see a beggar woman come in, and they both recognize her as this distraught, horrible, damaged person. we don't know at the time either, but it's actually Todd's wife, Lucy, and he can't recognize her, perhaps because of his anger. Obviously, he's singing about how the cruelty of men is as wondrous as Peru. Anthony thinks the world's wonderful, but Todd knows better because of his specific experience. So there's a kind of a sad irony that runs through the show. And the fact that he cannot recognize this beggar woman, and the reason why Sondheim made her so distraught, obviously she's got a number of personalities working there. She's been so terrified that she herself is not recognizable as Lucy anymore. So that has to be established very clearly on. And here's another thing that needs to be established. Todd goes and wants to eat something, so he goes to have a meat pie. So this is where he gets to meet Mrs. Lovett. So this is the worst pies in London.
Mm-hmm. what's your hurry? You gave me such a fright, I thought you was a ghost. Half a minute, can't you sit? Sit you down, sit. All I meant is that I haven't seen a customer for weeks. Did you come here for a pie, sir? Do forgive me if me head's a little vague. Ooh, what is that? But you think we have a plague? From the way the people keep avoiding, now you don't. Heaven has a try, sir. But there's no one comes in even to inhale. Right you are, sir, would you like a drop of ale? Mind you, I can't hardly blame them. These are probably the worst pies in London. I know what it takes to take them. I should know, I make them. But good now, the worst pies in London. Even that's polite, the worst pies in London. If you doubt it, take a bite. Is that just disgusting? You have to concede it. It's nothing but crusting. You drink this, you'll need it.
So she gives him a beer and says, you're going to need this eating my pies because they are definitely the worst pies in London. There's a lot of humor to that. But it's also very important to set up that, boy, if she had better meat, she'd probably do a much better business. So it's setting up for something much later. We also get to meet Mrs. Lovett and find out what a character she is. Humorous, but at the same time, rather desperate. You don't really trust her, just as in a way it's kind of hard to trust Sweeney. But he is an admirable person, especially when she now tells the story because she recognizes him as... the original person who lived there, Benjamin Barker, but she tells the story of what happened to Lucy, that she was taken to this party after Sweeney was sent to Australia, and she went crazy because they basically the judge raped her, and then she tells him that she poisoned herself. So Mrs. Lovett tells a lie here, which is going to factor in to Sweeney's belief that that his wife is no longer. And that's going to provide a dark ending for us as well. But she also gives him his shaving utensils. And there was a wonderful song that Sweeney has where he sings My Friends. And he's reunited to his purpose because now he's going to get revenge on the judge. So we now have a revenge tragedy brewing. Meanwhile, Anthony has met someone who he falls in love with, and this provides another interesting aspect to the story. So he sees Joanna and wants to take her away, but Joanna is Judge Turpin's ward, the daughter of Lucy, who he had raped. So this is how Anthony meets her. He actually buys her a bird, a singing bird, and gives it to her. Now watch to see what happens when Judge Turpin and Beetle Bamford show up.
I feel you, Joanna, I feel you. I was half convinced I'd waken, satisfied enough to dream you. Happily I was mistaken, Joanna. I'll steal you, Joanna, I'll steal you.
Joanna. Joanna!
Oh, dear!
If I see your face again, on this or any other neighbor's street, you'll rue the day you were born. Is that plain enough speaking for you?
But, sir, I swear to you, there was nothing in my heart but the most respectful sentiments.
Dispose of him. You, get your room. Quickly!
You heard his worship. But, friend, I have no fight with you.
Get the gist of it, friend.
Next time, it'll be your neck.
Joanna, if I were to think that you encouraged that young rogue.
Dear father, I hope always to be obedient to your commands.
Oh, dear child, how sweet you look in that light muslin gown.
I'll steal you, Joanna. I'll steal you. Do they think that walls can hide you? Even now I'm at your window. I am in the dark beside you. Very sweetly in your yellow hair.
Chris Cronendahl, a wonderful performance as Anthony. Actually, Victor Garber had started that role on Broadway at first. But notice how that wonderful song, Joanna, stands out in this grotesque musical. We need that. We need some kind of comforting sound. Wonderful significance to the bird that's caged and how Judge Turpin's beetle comes by and kills the bird. So we have another ambition in the play, another goal, which is Anthony to free Joanna. And these things are going to combine very well with Todd. Meanwhile, Todd is going to win £5 from a confrontation with Monsieur Pirelli in a contest that they have over shaving someone, who can shave that person the quickest. But Pirelli recognizes, it's a very humorous scene, but he recognizes the shaving instruments and knows who Todd is. And Pirelli will go to Todd later to try to blackmail him, and that means Pirelli's going to be the first victim of Sweeney to his razors. And I think we're going to go to that section called A Little Priest. I think we'll show that little clip if we can. And this is where they're trying to figure out, what are we going to do with Pirelli's body? We've got it up there in the trunk, and we've got to get rid of it somehow. So I'd like to actually show that little section of A Little Priest from Sweeney Todd.
Well, there's a baby lamb. Later I'll fob him off with some story. But him, what are we going to do with him?
Later on, when it's dark, we'll take him to some secret place and bury him.
Well, yes. We can do that, of course. I don't suppose he's got any relatives gonna come poking around looking for him. Well, you know me. Bright ideas just pop into my head and I keep thinking. Seems a downright shame.
Shame?
Seems an awful waste. Such a nice plum friend, what's his name, has? Has, nor it can't be traced. Business needs a lift, debts to be erased. Think of it as thrift, as a gift. If you get my drift. Now, seems an awful waste. I mean, with the price of meat, what it is, when you get it. If you get it.
Ah!
Good you got it. Take for instance Mrs. Mooney and a pie shop. Business never better using only pussycat and toast. And a pussy's good for maybe 6 or 7 at the most. And I'm sure they can't compare as far as taste.
Mrs. Lovett, What a charming notion, mathematically practical, and yet appropriate as always. Mrs. Lovett, how I've lived without you all these years, I'll never know.
Think about it. Lots of other gentlemen will be coming for the train. One day, think of all that price.
What's the sound of the world out there?
What, Mr. Todd? What, Mr. Todd? What is that sound?
Those crunching noises pervading the air.
Yes, Mr. Todd. Yes, Mr. Todd. Yes, sir.
It's man devouring man, my dear. And who are we to deny it?
So the major theme of the whole show right there, man devouring man. And now we're going to have Mrs. Lovett design. Here, would you like a little priest? This is a pie that I made with a little priest. And she goes through all these different categories. So it becomes a rather dark sense of humor. As Tiffany Mills, one of our students, said, Sweeney Todd was another first-time experience for me, and I enjoyed this musical thriller. It's different from the ones we've previously viewed. With its razor-sharp, cutting-edge stage and heart-pounding music, the performance is a gory, grimy extravaganza of the grotesque. Wonderful. It's frightening but exciting. After watching this musical, I will never look at pork pies the same. Thank you, Tiffany. And thank you, everyone, for tuning in. I hope you get a chance to see Sweeney Todd in its entirety. And next week will be our final broadcast. Thank you for joining the American Musicals.